So, real quick, you may have a seat, and welcome to Newport Foursquare tonight. And yeah, it's so cool to have you guys here. Just to give you a quick update with all the coronavirus stuff going on, is that this will actually be the last kind of official Saturday night we're meeting, as we're going to be suspending our weekend gatherings, physical gatherings, for the next couple of weeks. As we kind of just navigate the coronavirus thing. Each week we'll kind of keep updating and keep checking on it and let you guys keep you informed as to kind of how we're approaching that. That said though, I do encourage you if you want to be a part of the filming, so because we're going to continue to film some of these messages the opportunity and some of the worship at Saturdays at 5 o'clock, and so you're invited to come and be a part of that as long as you're healthy and you're not sneezing and you're not at risk of getting sick yourself. So with that, why don't you, I would say stand up and greet someone, but we're trying to kind of keep some distance, so why don't we just stand up and let's pray and just enter back into a time of worship tonight. So Father God, we thank you for tonight. We thank you for the opportunity to come into this place. And God, in times like this, especially, God, our hope, our trust is in you. And God, I pray that we would see some of the opportunities available around us as we go into our community, as we go into our neighborhoods, even as we, in those moments where we kind of isolate with family and friends, that we would take the opportunities just to be a light, Lord. Be a light to our neighbors, asking how they're doing, checking up on them, praying for them. I believe, God, you're going to use this time that in a time where it might seem like doors are kind of shutting, that would actually be a time where, God, you're going to do some of your greatest work even within and through our church in these coming weeks. As God, I believe you're going to put us in places, you're going to put us in situations, you're going to put us in conversations where we have opportunities to share the gospel message like never before. Be able to share this hope and this peace that we have in you, Jesus. This peace that passes understanding in this crazy, anxious world that we have in you. And so, Lord, we thank you for that opportunity, God. I pray we would embrace it wholeheartedly. And God, right now, we just want to just enter into a moment of worship and just reminding ourselves of who's really in control of it all. That God, we got this. We don't have to fear. We don't have to worry. Because we know the one who's in charge, who's working behind the scenes. Even when we can't see how it's all going to work out, we can trust that you're going to work it out for our good and ultimately your glory. In Jesus' name.
Oh, carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. By now they fall. but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for a chance to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. Promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never failed. Your promise still stands, great is your. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence. You may
She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her female slave to get it. She opened it and saw the baby. He was crying, and she felt sorry for him. "This is one of those Hebrew babies," she said. Then his sister asked Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get one of the Hebrew women to nurse this baby for you?" "Yes, go," she answered. So the girl went and got the baby's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this baby and nurse him for me, and I will pay you." So the woman took the baby and nursed him. When the child grew older, she took him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses. And I love his name, saying, "I drew him out of the water." I want you to find someone next to you, or if you're watching online, to yell out the title of my message. And really, it's more than a title. It's really a declaration. And that's simply this: I am not your average Joe. But find someone there, yell it out to the room if you're watching online: I'm not your average Joe. See, this is a message for anybody who's maybe in their 60s or 50s, their 40s, or even their 30s, and you've wondered at times, man, is this it? Like, you've looked at your life and you've wondered, is this all it's ever going to be? You know, is this what it all amounts to? The picket fence, the dog, the 2.5 kids, like, is this it? Like, will this be all I ever do with my life? I mean, and especially when we look at other people, right? Because, like, when I look at other people, let's be honest, sometimes it feels like they're so much further ahead in life. So much further ahead in life, which by the way, for those of you who are, like, you know, maybe you're watching this and you're thinking, hey, what about the 20s? Like, you left somebody out of that list. But listen, there's a reason for that. It's because you're in your 20s. Relax. Like, so it's crazy to me. Sometimes you get a 20-year-old to be on it. Like, I don't understand. I haven't done anything with my life yet. Breathe. You're 20. You're in your 20s. It's okay. But again, whatever stage of life that you're in, if you've ever asked yourself those questions, and I want you to meet Joe. I want you to meet Joe, because see, what I love about the story of Joe is because she's someone in the Bible that on the surface you might not think maybe lived the most significant of lives. As let's be honest, nobody talks about Joe. There's no sermon series on Joe. Like, hey, we're going to be doing 12 weeks on the life of Joe. No one tells Bible stories to their kids about Joe. And here's the reason why, is because, again, when you look at her life on the surface, again, it doesn't seem like she's accomplished anything of great substance. Like Joe didn't slay a giant. Joe didn't step out of a fire. Joe didn't defeat an army. At first glance, Joe might not seem that important, but her son, on the other hand, woo! Her son, that's a whole other story, right? Her boy Moses, like, everyone knows about Moses, right? Like, he's got 4 movies about his life. Exodus, 10 Commandments, Prince of Egypt, one of my personal favorites. Or probably my least favorite, Exodus, Gods and Kings, or God of Kings, because he's got that creepy little boy. He's supposed to resemble God. It's really, yeah, terrifies. Last Sunday, I mentioned Chucky in a movie. I had a Chucky reference. And this little boy in that movie is actually, I think, creepier than Chucky. So, yeah, anyway, off the topic. But the point is that, again, on the surface, Moses, I mean, we know what Moses has done. I mean, Moses has been more than well-documented, all the achievements of significance in Moses' life. In fact, did you know that there are 800 verses in the Bible that reference his name? 800 verses in the Bible that reference his name. Joe, on the other hand, just has 8 verses in the Bible that even reference her, and only 2 that actually specifically reference her name. Moses wrote 5 books of the 66 books of the Bible. Joe, her name is only in 1 of those books, and that's only because Moses kind of wants to give a shout out to his mom, kind of like, hey, love you, mom, # best mom ever, right? Like, he wants to kind of put that in there. Moses led a nation of millions out of Egyptian oppression. Joe has only her frustrations to navigate at dealing with 2 screaming boys all the time, which you could maybe argue which is the greater miracle and significance in that. But here's what I'm getting at. Now listen, when you compare the 2, on the surface it seems like one is not like the other. On the surface it seems like one is not as important as the other, until you realize that nothing Moses did would have ever been possible without Jehovah. Nothing Moses did would have ever been possible without Jehovah. And yet, not only that, though, but here's sort of the kicker about this, is that Joe never actually knew or got to really know on this side of eternity just how important she really was. Because you might think that maybe as like a proud mom, like Moses comes back home to Egypt and says, hey, let my people go. And here's Joe sort of standing right next to him like, that's my baby boy. That's my boy. Like, he's calling down fires. Like, did you see that? Nobody calls down fire like my boy does. Like, it's amazing. You might have thought that Joe got to at least, at the very least, see the significance and the pride that she had as a mom of Moses. But what you may not know is by the time Moses gets back to Egypt, he's already 80 years old. His mom is long gone by then. Never getting to learn of her full significance to the Bible story until she gets to heaven. But wow, can you just imagine what it was like when she first stepped into eternity, stepped into heaven? Can you imagine the people running up to her and like, thank you. Thank you. Listen, if it wasn't for you raising a boy like Moses, if it hadn't been for what you did, I wouldn't be here. If it hadn't been for the Ten Commandments and this ultimate revealing and the beginning of initiating kind of God's picture and plan for redemption of humanity, like, if it wasn't for what you did, I don't know if I would be here right now. If you had done what you did. Here's what I'm trying to get you to see is that, and this is really kind of the big point, the big gist of this whole message, is you've got to understand is that you don't need prominence to have significance. You do not need prominence to have significance. Or put another way, do not judge how much greatness is in you by how many eyes are upon you. Don't judge how much greatness is in you by how many eyes are upon you. In fact, we see this actually just comparing kind of Joe and Pharaoh's life. In fact, let's kind of go back and look at this. Exodus 1:22. Then Pharaoh, it says, gave this order to all his people. Every Hebrew boy that is born, you must throw into the Nile, but let every girl live. But here, check out Joe's portion. Exodus 2:1 says, now a man of the tribe of Levi married a Levite woman, Joe, and she became pregnant and gave birth to a son. Now here's what you got to get. Pharaoh, at this time, he was a very important person. You know, by every cultural measurement of the day, he was incredibly important. In fact, especially back in that day and age, he would have been seen not just as an important person, but he was seen as king, he was seen as a god to some people, a well-educated leader of one of the world's most powerful nations and militaries. But when it comes to this picture, a picture that would ultimately be reflective of this New Testament reality of God's plan for redemption, this historical moment in time when God chooses to highlight this story in Scripture, whose name gets the shout-out? Whose name is remembered? I mean, think about this. What's Moses' mom's name again? Not a trick question. Joe. That's right, Joe. Joe, not a trick question. Now, what's Pharaoh's name? This one is kind of a trick question because we don't have it. You gotta like bring you up, bring your confidence up, and bring you down, right there. But we don't know Pharaoh's name because Pharaoh is not a name. Pharaoh is a title. Pharaoh is a title. As pharaohs had names during that day, like Minatuk, Ramses, Tut, those were actual names, but. Again, I share this. Why is that important? Because when God chose to retell one of the most important stories in all of history, listen, Pharaoh doesn't even get his name mentioned, but the stay-at-home mom gets the shout-out. Pharaoh doesn't even get his name mentioned, but the stay-at-home mom gets the shout-out. Again, you don't need prominence to have significance when it comes to the kingdom of God. And just because your actions are not always seen by others doesn't mean that they're not always heard by God. Noticed by God, celebrated by God. I remember in high school, I think it was about senior in high school, and we were, it was summertime, I was out late with some friends, and we kind of had this, I should say my friends had this great idea, because I if you know anything about me, I'm not a very good swimmer. I like to be on top of the water, not in the water. And they came up with this idea, like, hey, wouldn't it be cool if we snuck onto the golf course and we swam out? They had this basically this little pond with this kind of floating chipping green in the middle of it. And like, how cool would it be in the middle of the night to sneak out there, swim out to the putting green, the chipping green that's in the middle of this pond, and then swim back? And again, I wasn't maybe the brightest of kids at that time, and so I was like, sure, why not? So we jump into the pond and we start swimming there. And again, I think part of the reason I don't like swimming is because I have no buoyancy whatsoever. Like I just sink. So my form of swimming is I can swim as far as I can hold my breath. It's underwater. The whole thing is underwater. And so I jump in the water and kind of follow my friends out to this floating, you know, green in the middle of this pond, and I start swimming there, and I make it to the green. Going a lot of exertion, a lot of struggle, I make it there, and I'm like, okay, this isn't so bad. I can do this. So anyway, we hang out there a little bit, and then we jump back in the water to swim back to the banks of the shore. And so they all head in the water, and they jump there on the last one to make my dive, and so I dive in, and I start swimming, and again, you know, I swim under the water, so my only way of actually knowing where I'm at is by touch. Like, so I'm swimming, and I'm trying to kind of feel, you know, for some land, trying to feel for something I can grab, but the problem is, I'm not touching anything. I'm swimming, I'm starting to run out of breath, and I feel nothing. I feel nothing. In fact, to the point where, in my mind, I'm like, this is it. This is how I'm going to go down. The kid who died, you know, just swimming, following his friends in the pond. He's like, this is bad. This is the end of my days, the end of my life right here. And so I'm swimming, and right as I'm kind of getting to that point of just kind of surrendering to it all, I remember just reaching out, and I felt the ground of the bank. And I was so relieved, so overjoyed. Of course, my buddies were like, hey, you want to do it again? Yeah, no. No, thank you. But I share the story because what was really significant about that story was I remember the next day. I remember waking up and hanging out in the kitchen. And I remember my mom, she asked me, she's like, hey, everything okay? I'm like, yeah, things are good. I didn't go into details of what happened. But thankful to be alive after last night. But she goes, the reason I asked is because I just felt really impressed to pray for you last night. And so I was praying for you. And I just want to make sure everything's okay. And again, I still didn't go into details because I knew I would get in trouble. So it's like yeah, everything's fine. I'll try to hold back tears. Yeah, it was all good, right? And listen, I share that with you because here's my mom, you know, by that act of responding to the leading of the Spirit to pray for me. And listen, there wasn't anyone around to give her an amen, anyone around to give her high fives, anyone around to say, hey, way to go. But how many know her prayers for me that night, I believe, literally saved my life. Literally saved my life. And listen, raise your hand, just out of curiosity, if you ever prayed for anybody, have you ever prayed for anyone in life? Yeah. Then you should never, ever feel insignificant. You should never, ever feel unimportant because you have no idea the extent of your prayer. You have no idea the lives you've changed, the people that you've impacted, the destinies that you've shifted just by getting on your knees and saying, God, protect my son. God, protect my boy. God, protect my daughter. God, protect my friend. God, show up in the life of my neighbors or my coworkers. Guard them. Give them hope. See, when we pray even over the services, we believe that things are shifting, things are changing in the atmosphere. Again, there is more significance hidden within you than I think so many of us realize. And listen, not just your prayers, my dad, but your actions too. They matter. They matter. You know, I'm so grateful for our kids' ministry volunteers. You're talking about serving behind the scenes week in and week out. I'm so thankful for Chris and the worship team. I know sometimes you might think they just kind of show up there and just start singing whatever song comes to the top of their mind. But they show up during the week and they practice when there's no one around to join in, no one around to acknowledge what they're doing. I think of our admin team. I think of Aretha and Melody and the incredible amount of stuff they do behind the scenes. I think of those who work with our students. I think of Jeremy and Sarah who drive all the way from Florence every single week just to invest in the lives of our next generation, or the sound team. Think of all that Jessica does back there. In fact, many of you wouldn't even be watching today without what she does. We couldn't even do it. And again, nobody ever sees them, nobody ever thinks of them, but we couldn't do what we do without them. We couldn't. Point being, a lot of our deeds in life are hidden, but just because they're hidden doesn't mean they don't matter. In fact, I believe some of the greatest significance you and I will ever have in this world is often hidden to begin with. In fact, if you doubt that, all you got to do is just do a quick skim read through the Bible. It's just story after story of hidden figures that God would use to do incredibly significant, world-changing things. Think about Joe. Joe was hidden. Moses was hidden. He was hidden in a basket in the reeds at one point. Gideon, who would ultimately go on to lead the nation of Israel out of the oppression of the Midianites. He started off hidden in a wine press. We think of David, who would be the greatest king of all. But he started out hidden as a little boy in the shepherd fields, ever long before he ever took on Goliath, long before his name ever got any recognition. We think of Josiah, who, when he was 8 years old, became the king of Israel. But before that, he was hidden in the temple of God in the back room somewhere. I don't know how that fully worked, but he was there hiding out for all those years before he ever became recognized. Even Jesus started off hidden. Hidden in a manger, hidden behind a cow and some livestock. Listen, the point is don't complain that you're hidden. Because again, some of God's greatest, most significant works in life, they start off in hidden places within hidden lives. Again, don't mistake prominence for significance. Don't mistake prominence for significance. In fact, I think this is actually one of the great paradoxes of Jesus' teaching. Because let's be honest, it runs so countercultural to what so many of us equate with significance. How so many of us connect achieving great things, achieving success, what we even picture as success. See, I think for many of us, when we think of significance, we think of this. Like if I want to do something of significance, if I want to do something that really matters, then the goal of my life, and so many of us, we spend our lives living for this, right? Like if I just climb the ladder of success. And so what happens for a lot of us is when we go, we kind of buy into this kind of rat race of mindset. And we think, if I want to do something significant, do something noteworthy in my life, then maybe I graduate high school. So that's a step on the line, right? Then maybe it's like for us, we graduate college. That's cool. Graduated college. I don't really want to go too much higher than this. I'm also a bit terrified of heights. Maybe you get to the place where you find that someone, right? You find that special someone. Find that special someone, and kind of feels like you went back a step, maybe too. Maybe you get that dream job. You get that dream job, and you get that corner office, you get that house, and you just kind of keep going up. But can I tell you something that the enemy does not want you to know about this? Kind of the dirty secret of kind of the ladder of success. And what so many of us unfortunately live for, and we realize once we do get to the top of it, is that at the top of this, how many know what's up here? Nothing. The joy we thought we were going to get, the satisfaction we thought we were going to get, the fulfillment we thought we were going to get, is nothing. Now let me be clear what I'm not saying as much as what I'm saying. I'm not saying that it's not good to try to do well in your job, try to achieve great things, try to make your mark in the world. I think those are great things. But what I'm getting at is what's your goal in climbing the ladder? Where are you going? Because you know where this ladder actually finds its value? Where this ladder actually finds its sense of worth? It's when you put a purpose to it. When you put a purpose to it. See, when I take this ladder, and if I were to move it over maybe to one of those lights, and then I climb up, so I could use that ladder then to actually achieve a purpose. To change the light bulb or maybe, fix the speakers. Here's the point. What I'm trying to get at is that the value of this ladder, what you got to understand, is not at the apex of the ladder. The value of the ladder is found in its purpose. It's found in its purpose. And here's why that is so significant for what we're talking about. It's because if we're honest, I think a lot of us would have to say when it comes to the ladder of our lives, probably looks a little bit more like this than that. I mean, I'll be like when I was 18, don't get me wrong, I thought my ladder was going to be this. I'm going to change the world. I'm going to be president. I'm going to be an NBA superstar. Like when you're 18, that's what you think with the ladder. But then, you know, somewhere like 30 happens, 40 happens in my case, and you realize your ladder's a whole lot shorter than maybe you envisioned it was going to be. And here's the beauty of this, and why I say this is so important that we get this, is because when you understand the value of something, it's not found in its height, it's not found in its prominence, but it's found in its purpose. It changes how you see it. It changes everything about it. Because here's the thing, with this ladder, there's a reason this kind of ladder stays in the church. It's because we don't really have room in our house, room in our garage, for a ladder like this, you know. But a ladder this size, like we got tons of ladders in the garage that are kind of a variance of this size, this kind of height, because this ladder I can actually use to get in some places. Here's what I want you to get. I can use this ladder to get to places and spaces I could never get to with this ladder. With this ladder. See, here's what I'm trying to get at. It's while a platform, platform can come in a bunch of different varieties and sizes. The beauty is with purpose comes in one. And when you add purpose, a purpose beyond yourself with what you do, it comes in one size, and that one size is great. Platform comes in different sizes, but purpose comes in one, simply put, great. In fact, I like Ephesians 2:10, how it puts it. It says, "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared for us in advance to do." A couple of key things you got to get there. One is that you were created on purpose for a purpose. And that purpose is bigger than just living just for yourself. But it's also the significance of that. And this is why I say, you're not average. You're not average. In fact, to God, there is no average. There's no such thing. It does not exist in his vocabulary. Because to say you're average is to say that there are others like you. And newsflash, there's only one you. There's only one you. But not just that. And I think this may be even the more significant part, or just as significant of a part of that verse, is the second part of it. Is that it speaks to us that not only were you designed for your environment, but get this, your environment was designed for you. Your environment was designed for you. So that means that people have been placed strategically in your life. That means the job that you hate so much, there's a reason for it. It was designed by God even before time began. As God didn't just make you for your job, he made your job for you. That family for you, those co-workers for you. And because of this, that not only is there hidden significance in all of us, but you've got to understand there are hidden opportunities all around us. Hidden opportunities all around us. If we just take the time to quit complaining about all the things we feel we don't have or the places we don't feel that we're at, and actually embrace and make the most of what God has given us, the opportunities God has placed around us, and really lean into those. And that's why I love the story of Job, because that's exactly what she did. That's exactly what she did. Check this out. Exodus 2, verse 2 through 3. It says, Job, again, she became pregnant, gave birth to a son. When she saw that he was a fine child, she hid him for 3 months. But when she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him, coated it with tar and pitch. Then she placed the child in it and put it among the reeds along the bank of the Nile. Again, here's this woman who, I think, by all accounts, when you read of her story, read of her life, we don't read of someone who had great prominence. We don't read of someone who had a lot of gifting. We don't read of someone who had some special talents or special set of skills like Liam Neeson. We don't read of a person who had much of anything. We don't even read of someone who had a lot of time. And in fact, check this out, verse 3. Notice the urgency, the rush of the situation. It says when she could no longer hide him. You know, and I point that out because, you know, so many times, a lot of times, I hear people all the time like, oh, I just don't have time. Like, I love, if I was like a full-time pastor like you, or if I was in a full-time ministry, then I could really do something. Like if I had all that time. But listen, you need to understand, and we get this from Job's life, you don't need time to make the most of a moment. You don't need time to make the most of the moment. See, Joe, rather than complain what she did have, chose to make the most of what she did have, but by making the most of her a moment. You might ask, well, what do you mean by the moments? Well, I don't know. Maybe for you, that moment is at a restaurant. Maybe for you, the moment is at the coffee, shop, drive-through, or at a grocery store. See, I want you to give this, is that, can I tell you what my prayer lately has been for my life, and really not just my life, but for all of us, especially in a season like this, is that God would help us to not check out on Christ, to see the opportunities that are all around us, the somewhat hidden opportunities that carry incredible significance and opportunity to make kingdom impact all around us. That during the season where so many are self-isolating, that we would make the most of the hidden opportunities that are all around us. So for some of us, maybe it's praying for our friends and our family. Maybe for some of us, maybe it's tipping a little extra when you go through the coffee drive-through lane or the restaurant. Maybe for some of you, it's checking on your neighbors by dropping them an extra roll of toilet paper off on their doorstep. I'm telling you, that stuff is like gold. I would be so thankful if our neighbors did that. Or maybe it's even something even as small as when you go to Freddy's, putting the grocery cart back in the cart rack like you're supposed to, rather than an animal, right? I just, you can tell it's personal to me. But you never know. You never know how some of the smallest things can have the greatest of impacts on people's lives. There's significance in those moments. See, again, there's hidden significance to your life. There's hidden opportunities around your life. And this may best be revealed in the very name of Jochebed herself. Listen, I want to wrap up with this. But there's something powerful to Jochebed's name. Jochebed's name, her full name. And you got to understand about Jochebed's name is it's really made up of two names, two parts to her name. The first part is Jo. And Jo comes from, is connected with, it's where we actually get the word Jehovah, or the name Jehovah, which is actually the first name in the Bible. It's actually the first name in the Bible that actually contained that reference to Jehovah. It's before we get the Jehovah Shin, Jehovah Has, all those things, even Josiah. It started right here with her name. In other words, half her name, the first part of her name means God. The first part of her name means God. But check out the next part of her name. I like this. It is Shabbat, but actually, it'd be better in Hebrew. It's actually pronounced the Shebed, which literally means honor. Honor. Now, if you're unsure what honor means, we first read about honor in the Ten Commandments, where it talks about honoring your father and mother. And if you're a parent, you know what that really means. It means, simply put, pay attention, right? Pay attention. And so here's where the significance of her name is found. Because when you take those definitions, when you put it all together, here we see this woman who nobody saw, the woman who nobody clapped for, the woman who died thinking that her life meant nothing because there was never a book in the Bible written about her. And parents weren't telling their kids stories about the incredible life of Job. People didn't sing songs about Job. But when you look at this woman who seems like a nobody, whose life in a lot of ways didn't seem like it amounted to much on the surface, and you put the words of her name together, check out what her name means. Jochebed means God is paying attention. God is paying attention. And listen, I came here to share that with some of you tonight, some of you watching online. You need to know God is paying attention to you. God sees you. God hears you. Oh, yeah, but Pastor, you don't understand. And nobody sees me. That's okay. God's paying attention. Maybe I'll never do anything that the world would identify or classify as significant. I'll probably maybe never be a doctor, maybe never be a lawyer. I'll never be a pastor of a church of thousands. But can I tell you something? God is paying attention. I may never make six figures. I may never do anything that shows up in the headlines of the news. I may never lead nations. No one may remember my name when I'm gone. But that's okay. Because you know who will? You know who does see you? You know who does what you do and the life you live matters to? God is paying attention to everything you do. He sees you when nobody sees you. He loves you when nobody else loves you. He's got his eyes on you. He's focused on you. In the mundane, in the everyday, in the seemingly average. On Monday, when you go back to work, if you go back to work, God's paying attention. Wednesday, when you clock in, when you're, you know, maybe you're on a Sunday or on Saturday, when church gathers again on the weekend, and you're back in that kids' ministry area, and kids are screaming and going crazy, and you wonder, why did I sign up for this? Listen, God's paying attention. God's paying attention. When you're on your knees, you're praying for your family, you're praying for your city, you're praying for your spouse, you're praying for your husband, praying for your daughter. Listen, you need to know God's paying attention. He sees you, and you're not alone. And because of that, listen, you can trust, and you can know, and you can walk with confidence this week that, listen, my life has value. My life has worth. My life has significance. Because there's a God who loves me. And even if the world doesn't see most of what I do in my life, if ever, the one thing I can trust is God always sees everything I do. And he looks upon us, and even those small deeds, those small things that seem like they don't matter at all, listen, they matter to God. He sees it. He celebrates it. He's rejoicing with what you're doing, the steps you're taking, the life that you're living. Listen, you matter. You matter more than I think oftentimes we even realize in the eyes of God. I want to pray for you this weekend. Father, I want to pray for those, especially who maybe hear this. And again, they look at their life and maybe they've taken some missteps. Maybe they've taken some steps that they know wasn't really what you to live the life that you called them to live. That God has this call to live a life of impact, a life of significance, a life that matters, a life that's bigger than ourselves, and yet for whatever reason we decide to go our own way or do our own thing. But listen, my prayer is that they would hear your heart, God. That we serve a God who doesn't stand with arms, extended out in judgment and condemnation, but a God who welcomes us with open arms and says, listen, I see you, I notice you, I still love you, I still got a plan for you, I still got a purpose for you. And so if that's you, if you come in this place, and or maybe you're watching online, and again, maybe for you, you've never really heard of this. All you've heard is how your life doesn't matter. All you've heard is the voice in your own head that tells you that this average, mundane life that you've been living, it doesn't matter for anything. And listen, if that's you, my prayer is that you would hear the voice of God. That you hear that still, small whisper of a God who would speak into you. No. You matter to me. You matter to me. And listen, if you doubt how much you matter, all you have to do is look at that cross. You hear that the value of something is ultimately determined, I believe, by the price someone's willing to pay for it. And when it came to you, and when it came to the issue and the question of your worth, God answered that by saying, listen, to God, you're worth everything. For God so loved the world. And again, there's no fine print to that. There's no exceptions to that. Like, God loves just good people or put together people. No, God loves the world. God loves you. And he gave his one and only son. He gave up everything for you, that you would know that you are worth everything to him. You're worth everything to him. And so could it be that you're watching this, or you come into a place like this, because God is wanting you to take that step into a relationship with him. Take a step into the journey of discovering your true worth, the true worth that is found in Christ alone. This relationship with a God who sees so much love and so much potential and so much value in you. And so if that's you, if you want to take that step, to ask Jesus to come into your life, to take that first step in this journey to the center of your true worth, I invite you to simply pray this prayer with me in your heart. And simply this, God, I recognize that I've messed up more than a few times. I've slipped up more than I care to admit. And yet, Jesus, I believe you love me enough to come on this rescue mission, to leave heaven, to come to earth, to pay a price in full for all of my sin and all of my shame, past, present, future. And because of which, Jesus, I'm asking you to come into my life, to be Lord and Savior of my life. that the same baggage maybe I have brought in here, because of your grace and because of your mercy, the same insecurities I have brought into this, listen, I don't have to walk out of here with. I can walk out of here in the knowledge of knowing that I've got a worth that's not based on what I achieve or what I do or what I don't do, but my worth is in knowing who I am as a son, as a daughter, as a child of God. Forgiven, free, with life eternal and life abundant because of you, Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.
Trust me, I'm faithful, I'm good. I've got good things in store for you. You are
best days are in front of you, not behind you. And so, God, we hold on to that. And we walk confidently in that. God, we're so thankful for your goodness, so thankful for your grace, so thankful for this time together. In Jesus' name.